So, you know, we've done a lot of dialogues around the world, as you probably know, and we try and make them different. And we want to have a lot of time for questions and answers, so we'll try and limit it, what we do together to as short a time as we can. But what we did today was talk to each other about some ideas, questions we have for each other that we thought might lead to somewhere. So we'll see. We never know where these things are going to go, but we'll start. But I thought I'd give Richard the first chance.
Well, thank you. Is this microphone on?
No.
Please switch it on. Hello?
I'll translate for you. No. Is microphone, is it turned on?
It was said to be turned on.
It's lights on.
Hello? So she went into the garden to pick a cabbage leaf to make an apple.
It's not working. Okay, he's going to come. Meanwhile, talk amongst yourselves, and it's interesting because we were just together in Pasadena, and I think doing two different things, and I think it spurred some of the questions that are going to happen.
Hello?
There you go. There you go. Okay.
First of all, I should clarify, Robin Blumner is not my assistant. She is the CEO of the Richard Dawkins Foundation.
Yeah.
Okay, first question. Imagine no religion. Could we hope for change, the complete abolition of religion, in a generation, a century, a millennium?
Okay, now, I was thinking about this because I actually talked about this subject when I received my American Humanists Award a few weeks ago in Denver. And I'm normally not optimistic. I'm actually generally pessimistic. But as a good friend of mine who's a famous pessimist says, he says, I'm a pessimist, but that's no reason to be gloomy. But we're always only one generation away from change. And there's no hope for adults, okay? But there's hope for children. And if you look at what's happened, especially in the United States in the last year, less than a year, 2 years maybe, somewhere between a year and two, about gay marriage. I mean, 2 years ago, it looked like many states were still gonna think of a constitutional amendment to ban gay marriage. And now it's a done deal. It's a done deal not because it's gone through all the courts and the old white men and the Supreme Court and old white women too, not all white women anymore, are going to make a decision, because it doesn't matter, because the younger generation, it's not an issue for them. People my daughter's age, they don't understand what the issue is with gay marriage. And they're going to, you know, grow up and they're going to become the lawyers and the congresspeople and the judges and the media, the journalists, and so it doesn't really matter what the current generation thinks. It's over. It's a done deal. So it's always one generation away, and I started to think about the fact that we need to, and in fact, following, I suppose, what Peter said a little bit earlier today, we just need to encourage doubt in the schools. Doubt. So we really need to encourage teachers to be willing to confront things that are wrong in school. And it's really important because most teachers, there was a recent survey, I think almost 70% of high school teachers avoid discussing issues of evolution or anything that touches on religion for fear of offending parents in particular. But that's exactly what they should be doing, because teachers, the purpose of teachers is to get students to not listen to their parents and not listen to the teachers, but to be critical and to encourage them to doubt everything they hear. So I actually think that when I look at what's happened with gay marriage, that although it seems like religion has been a part, and it has been a part of humanity since its origins, that really, because we're only one generation away, if we actively encourage through education doubt in children, then in a few generations I think there's hope.
Well, I agree that we need to break the cycle of things being simply passed from generation to generation. That is really, really pernicious. But I don't think it's going to be all that easy to do, especially in the Islamic world, which is where the big problem is. I mean, Islam is one of the great evils in the world today. Mm-hmm. And it is taken as more or less axiomatic that children, especially in the Islamic world, are going to grow up in the same religion as their parents. You see dire demographic projections saying by the year 2050, 50% of the French population will be Muslim or something of that sort. That's based entirely upon the assumption that every little child born is going to inherit the religion of its parents. That's what that kind of demographic statistic is based on. So if we could find a way to break the cycle, if we could find a way to chop off the automatic daisy chaining of religious opinion going down through the generations, we'd have it made. I mean, if only there was a sort of drug that would make everybody forget their religion and then wake up the next morning.
But that's what I'm saying. I mean, it may sound naive in some ways, but the only way I can see moving that wedge is education. At
yes.
some level, if we can start in the first world, if you want to say it, encouraging teachers to say, you know, the scriptures are incompatible with what we know about science.
But I wonder whether we might not simply write off the adult world and try to convert the adult world, because they're the ones who are going to influence the children. I mean, let me tell one anecdote. I've told it before, but we had a young man come to Oxford who was a young earth creationist. He came from Washington State, actually, and he believed the world was only 10,000 years old and all that. And he came to my lectures. I gave a course of 8 lectures on evolution, and he came to all of them. And at the end of the 8 lectures, he came down to the front, slammed his fist on the desk, and said, "Gee, this evolution, it really makes sense." What we were up against with him was not prejudice, was not bigotry, it was simply ignorance. He just didn't know any better, because he'd been educated. I won't mention the name of the college where he was. He had simply not been properly educated.
But that's the problem. I mean, if you look at the Taliban and you look at ISIS, if you look at the most extreme versions, that is what they want. They want to encourage ignorance.
Yeah.
And so I don't see any hope but to try and infiltrate that through education. Ultimately, I see hope, because I think that ultimately to become once there's a lot of upheaval going on now, and I don't think Islam is any different than Christianity was 500 years ago in terms of its violence.
500 years is a long time.
It's a long time. Yeah. It's started 500 years later, and it's more dangerous because we live in a world where you can create more problems, especially internationally with access to social media, as we heard earlier today. But in those societies, I think that ultimately we'll have to recognize that science and technology, first of all, are an essential part of becoming economically viable. So there's going to be overhauls and lots of violence. Yeah. But ultimately, to rise up, you have to start educating kids in science and technology, because you got to get a skilled workforce. It's happening to some extent in India and certainly in China.
I mean, I'm optimistic in North America, South America, Europe. I'm not optimistic in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh. And because I don't understand how we're going to manage that infiltration. But perhaps we should go on to another question.
Yeah, okay. I think it's going to be, I like to, it's one of the few moments when I like to think of something good about the world. Most of the time I don't. But but speaking of imaginal religion, this is a question that we were talking about a little bit. I think one of us got asked it in Pasadena. Because people, we always get hit with this thing, science is no different than religion. Because, scientists have faith. And isn't faith in science the same as faith in religion? So, it's an important thing for people to hear, because you'll get asked it if you haven't been asked it already.
It is amazing how often we get asked that.
Yeah,
The whole point about faith, of course, is that it's belief without evidence, whereas the whole point about science is that it is evidence. I mean, it's the only evidence that's applicable to the real world. And so to say that we have faith, I mean, in a sense, we sort of do. I mean, we have faith in logic, we have faith in mathematics, but you don't need faith because it works.
That's the key point. I think that's the point that it's, if you're a scientist working on something, a physicist, say, because that's science, and you're working for 10 years on something, you've at some level, you've got to you think it's worth working on, so you have faith that it'll work out. But the point is that you're willing to throw it out in an instant. It's because you have faith that it's a good idea, but you find out if it's a good idea in the end, not by you, but by nature. And so it's a difference. The kind of faith that I think religion has is, as I said before, is having the answers before you ask the questions.
Yes.
In science, you have faith that the questions are good questions. And you don't know what the answer is going to be.
A related question is, but you have faith that your wife loves you, or something of that sort. That's pure faith. Well, it isn't pure faith. It's, again, evidence. It's evidence based upon words. It's evidence based upon looks. It's evidence based upon little catches in the voice. There are all kinds of evidence that your wife loves you. You may be mistaken.
That's the thrill of being a scientist, is being mistaken.
So you reject the hypothesis when
and move on, hopefully. Yeah.
But it's simply nonsense to say that there's any resemblance between faith that your wife loves you and faith in God.
You know, I think it's been on YouTube. I did some debates with a really creepy guy in Australia, William Lane Craig, whose name I try not to mention. Who you have been wise enough to refuse to debate. I'm very impressed. And I was amazed at the end of that debate. Unfortunately, it was done with moderators who were mostly idiots. But we were both asked, what would it take for you to, you know, change your mind? They asked me, what would it take for you to believe in God? And I said, evidence. And I was amazed when he was asked, he said, well, maybe if my daughter died or was killed, I might lose my faith in God. And I thought, wow, that's such a wimpy thing to say. I mean, for someone who really claims that they believe. So in some sense, even though he was arguing that he had faith in something that he couldn't measure or couldn't see, if some event happened, that would be a bit of empirical evidence that would turn him around. I was kind of amazed.
You're right, I don't. I have had a debate with him once. By mistake, I didn't realize he was invited at the last minute. But I mean, I don't debate with him, partly because I can't stand listening to him.
Well, actually, you know, I was a little hard on him then, because he had earlier talked about, I'd confront him with the fact, as you probably know, is it the Malachites in the New Testament?
Malachites,
you know, so God exhorts them to kill all the Malachites, women and children, and he... unbelievably, as an apologist for Christianity, said, well, you know, it's okay because the adults, Malachites, were evil, so they deserve to go to hell, and the children will go to heaven, so it's okay that they're all killed. And the people I felt sorry for were the Israeli soldiers who had to kill them, but that's the only people I felt sorry for. So when he said if his daughter died, he wouldn't believe in God, I said, what if she were a Malachite?
I mean, anyway. That's absolutely true what Lawrence has just said. It is a most monstrous thing that he I mean, any respectable theologian doesn't believe that there ever was a massacre of the Amalekites. But he does.
And
not
he thinks
only
it's
does
okay.
He believe, he thinks it's okay.
We shouldn't have brought his name up. He remained with us enough.
But the other thing is that he's a pompous pedant.
Yeah.
You really get sort of premise one.
Yeah, yeah.
Premise two, consequence three.
Yeah, he's very pedantic. He makes it seem like...
He pretends he's doing logic.
Yeah, okay, let me... So, yeah, it's your turn.
Okay, right. One of the problems that we have, I think everybody in this community has, is the extent to which we should worry about giving offence. Should we worry about giving offence? I suppose I should say that when Lawrence and I first met, we had a bit of a disagreement about this. I was giving a talk. Where was it again? It was.
I think the first talk was in Buffalo, but where we started to have this discussion was in San Diego.
Well, anyway, wherever it was, I gave my speech, and then somebody stood up in the audience, and the question was rather more articulate and barbed than I'm used to. And it was, of course, Lawrence. He complained that I was too aggressive. He complained in a very aggressive way.
Yeah, that, absolutely.
That I was too aggressive. we met afterwards in the bar, I think, and talked it over and decided to continue our discussion in the pages of the Scientific American.
So yeah, we did a dialogue for Scientific American.
So what's your position on that now?
Well, you know, I have to admit, I've come around a lot. I've seen, first of all, as all of you know, who know Richard, he's not nearly as aggressive as, I mean, this myth of him being strident, which is a word that started to get applied to me when I started to ask questions about whether you could make a universe without God, just simply asking the question, I got called strident, and I began to become more sympathetic, and I saw that, in fact, this sense of aggressive pit bull-like behavior was not always there, but more importantly, it really, my mind really came around, I think, with Charlie Hebdo in more recently, because, and I wrote a piece about it, I think offense, the person who, if you're offended, you own that problem. You're the person, you can decide how to respond. You can, if you're offended, first of all, you can decide whether you're going to be offended or not. Secondly, you can decide how to respond. Well, okay, I think you're wrong for this reason or this reason or this reason, or you can cut someone's head off or whatever. And so the response I have now, I think I learned from you, from our friend in England, what's his name, the tall guy. He said, so you're offended, so I offended you?
Oh, Stephen Fry.
Stephen Fry, yeah.
Yeah, Stephen Fry said, so you're offended? Well, so fucking what?
Yeah, exactly. I still think one has to, if you're trying to communicate, you've got to ask who you're communicating to and try and adjust your language to try and reach people, because people don't hear what you say unless they're prepared to hear what you say. So there's a lot of, and I've called it seduction in the past, and I think it's important, teaching is seduction.
Christopher Hitchens had a slightly different version of that, slightly more seductive version. Not much. He said, you're offended? I'm still waiting to hear your argument.
Yeah, that's exactly. That's the good line. The point is, if you're offended, think about it. But I think we need to offend at some level. But at the same time, I think we have to moderate that and realize that for different groups, different strokes for different folks, and it takes all kinds. And sometimes when we do dialogues and other things, one person might be the good cop and one person might be the bad cop, I think different approaches work for different people. In fact, in the movie, in The Unbelievers, you talked about the fact that your response to something that could have offended you, which was being told you were an idiot for reading that awful book by
Teilhard de Chardin.
Teilhard de Chardin.
Yes.
And your response was, you know what, I really was an idiot.
I really was an idiot.
Yeah.
I don't think we want to go around telling people they're idiots, not in so many words, but so many people will think you're saying that if you criticize what they believe, because it's as though their beliefs are part of them.
It's not even criticizing. That's what gets me. It's just asking questions.
Yes.
If you say, well, why do you believe that? That's a criticism. Why do you believe in God? It's taken as an offensive statement. And that's really what we have to try to conquer.
That's, I agree.
It's that every other area, you can ask, why are you Republican? And, you know, there's no good answer. But people are at least, you know, accept that you can ask the question, but somehow it's offensive to ask people about the religion. And until we get beyond that point where we can bring it up openly, then we're always going to have problems, I think.
Because people identify with their religion so much more than they identify with really anything. Maybe their football team. I'm not sure about that.
That's true. And if you ask why, it seems like it's an attack on them. Such a central part of their being.
Yes. But the story about Teilhard de Chardin is an interesting one, because as an undergraduate, has anybody read The Phenomenon of Man by Teilhard de Chardin? One or two people. I was seduced by it as an undergraduate until I read Peter Medawar's wonderful review, the finest negative book review ever written. And he said things like, he's a little bit careful here. He said, he compared it to the German Natur philosophy, and then he said, French is not a language that lends itself to the ponderous idiom of Natur philosophy. And Teilhard has accordingly resorted to that tipsy, euphoristic prose poetry which is one of the more tiresome manifestations of the French spirit. I apologize. On behalf of P.B. Medawar. And it's a magnificent takedown of this book, and I completely changed my mind. I felt a fool to have been seduced by this man. So it is possible to change somebody's mind. You don't automatically assume that if you show somebody to be an idiot, as I was shown to be, that you will always push back.
Yeah,
some people will change their mind.
But what you really did, and I when I lecture to physics teachers, I say the same thing, that there's just a lot of research, a ton of research, that the only way that we can teach things is by having people confront their own misconceptions. It's not by they have to work through it. And in some sense, his book review caused you to confront your own misconceptions. And we do that all the time. And that's the way people remember, is when they realize themselves that something they always thought was true is wrong. It's a wonderful experience. It's a liberating experience.
And I was playing last night with Peter Wahosian's app for how to convert people from religion. And you give them questions and you have to answer, is this the right answer, this the right answer. I got the wrong answer every single time. and the app said, that was too confrontational. But I think we kind of agree that works for some people.
It works for some people, and I think ultimately, and as I guess as Peter was saying again today, there's some people who are going to be offended no matter what you say. But I think you have to, Megan, I forget whether you said it here or whether you said it the other day, that when we're doing a debate or when we're doing something like that in a public forum, we're really not talking to the person we're trying to debate. We're really addressing the vast group in the middle who may have never thought about these issues. And so we may offend the person we're confronting, but the idea is to reach out to the people who are more or less of goodwill and often have not thought in detail about the issues in general.
That's such an important point. I was once at a conference, I think it was TAM, where somebody gave a talk called Don't Be a Dick. and he began by taking a vote. And he said, if somebody said you're an idiot, would that change your mind? And of course, everybody said no. Oh, that's fine. But what he didn't ask was, if you were listening to a person saying to a third party you're an idiot, would that change your mind? And that's a very different question.
That was the reason I decided to do these events with the person whose name we shall not mention anymore. Because it was put on by a Christian group in Australia. There were 2,000 people in each of those three events. And as painful as they were, it was an audience of goodwill. I'm going to ask you, let's move on.
Yeah, okay.
I'm going to do a science question. We were talking about aliens a lot lately. What might alien biology be like, do you think?
It's easy to criticize science fiction authors for their lack of imagination, making their aliens pretty much like humans, but bright green or something. I mean, just a varying one thing. And one's apt to praise a science fiction author who really, really stretches the imagination and thinks of something entirely different, like a living organism that's entirely in a gaseous medium rather than in a solid medium or something of that sort, or not carbon-based but silicon-based. I think it's arguable that alien life might actually be more like our sort of life than the pure imagination might suggest. For a start, I'd stick my neck out and say that alien life, if there is any, and I'm pretty sure there is going to be Darwinian life. I don't think I'd be very surprised if there was any other way in which the complex organization, the pseudo-purpose of life could come about by anything other than Darwinian natural selection. Once you've got an intelligence that's evolved by Darwinian evolution, then of course you've got the possibility of intelligent design manufacturing complicated things, which are evidence of life but are not life themselves, at least not yet. So I think it's a genuinely interesting question to ask, and I wish that more chemists and biologists would ask the question. Can you imagine, what kinds of alien life can you imagine? Does it have to be carbon-based? I talked to Harry Kroto, the Nobel Prize-winning chemist, about this a few months ago, and he said, absolutely, it's got to be carbon. He was very adamant about this. There's nothing else, no other element has the properties of carbon that can produce the sort of macromolecules that you need. I would chip in and say it's got to be Darwinian. That means there's got to be a genetics of some sort. My conjecture is it would have to be digital genetics, because it's got to be very high fidelity genetics. Otherwise, Darwinism doesn't work. And I think that probably means it's got to be digital. Analog genetics, I think, would be too subject to mutation. Would it have to be a one-dimensional code, as DNA is? Or could you imagine a two-dimensional genetic matrix? I think you could. I don't see why it shouldn't be two-dimensional. I doubt if it could be three-dimensional because of the difficulty of readout.
Yeah, yeah.
That's one of the reasons why protein could never serve as
the
genetic molecule.
From a chemistry perspective, I'm actually even more, I feel more strongly than Harry does. We had a meeting on, which you were at, the Origin of Life at ASU, and talking to the chemist and looking at the chemistry, I'm reasonably convinced that not only is it likely just to be carbon, but people have been thinking about whether you could have different base pairs. You know, we have these four base pairs on DNA. And I'm pretty sure it's chemistry that determines that, and which is ultimately physical arguments that determine energetically what can form and what can't. And I would be very surprised if life had a different code anywhere else. I mean, people have tried with five letters and six letters. There's a few people in Florida working on that. But I would go out so far as to say that I would be very surprised if it were actually ultimately different at all, if in fact it had anything different than carbon and a genetic code like we have. I think that ultimately things have been directed by energetics and entropy and as well as ultimately natural
you
selection.
You cannot mean the same genetic code. You could mean a triplet code.
Well, it could be, but I wouldn't be surprised if ultimately demands of fidelity combined with demands of molecular pairing led to something that was very similar. In any case,
I bet it would be a triplet code. No, sorry, I don't. I mean, I wouldn't mind that argument. Yeah. I'd be extremely surprised if it was the same triplet code.
Okay, we'll have a bet.
Another question would be, do you need protein
to
be the executive branch? And that I think is arguable. I mean, there's a good case for it. I think it probably is. Protein has marvelous properties. For making enzymes.
Yeah, absolutely.
For being coded by nucleic acids. I don't think there's any reason to suppose that the same 20 amino acids.
We'll talk about that maybe a little bit later. I'm not as convinced that in fact the set that has been chosen is just random. Okay. I think there may be energetic arguments, and I'm fascinated. See, I'd love to be wrong, but it would be interesting. The problem is, by the way, that that it's a very difficult question to answer. Because we are likely to find life elsewhere in our solar system. I suspect in the next century we'll find evidence for extant or extinct microbes. Now, if we see that they have the same genetic code, you might say, aha, well, it's always that way. The problem is no planet is an island. We already know that rocks get knocked out of Mars, come here, and microbes can certainly survive the voyage. So life on any one system in the solar system could easily pollute other areas of the solar system. Now, maybe under the oceans of Europa, Enceladus. Yeah, exactly. That's probably a better source right now. Then, because there's a barrier, you might say it's been so protected that it hasn't been affected at all by life on Earth. But the real way would be somehow to see life in a system that hasn't interacted with our own, and that's going to be obviously a lot harder.
If you move on to more sort of gross anatomy, things like eyes and ears and legs and things, I wouldn't be at all surprised if alien life had eyes, because light is a marvelous way of forming images. And there are only about 9 ways in which you can make an eye.
Yeah.
And all 9 of them have been adopted several times over in the animal kingdom on this planet. So I think it would be not at all surprising to find that on another planet there were eyes answering to the same principles as eyes that we have here, the camera eye, the compound eye, the parabolic reflector eye.
Again, that's because it's physics, right?
Yes, that's right. If the planet is not shrouded in perpetual fog, if light can travel freely in straight lines, then I would expect that eyes would evolve.
But
if there is perpetual fog, I'd expect echolocation to evolve.
What about symmetries?
Yeah,
what about symmetry?
Biological symmetries?
Yes. Biological
symmetries are interesting. Almost all animals are bilaterally symmetrical. Some phyla are symmetrical, radially symmetrical. Echinoderms are mostly 5-way symmetrical. I think you can think of sort of rather mundane good reasons why animals are bilaterally symmetrical. The difference between up and down is very important. The difference between front and back is very important. And unless you're going to go around in circles like the one-eyed Geiger, you're pretty much going to be symmetrical in the left-right.
This all also represents a kind of myopia. We talk about life being carbon-based, but in fact, we live at a time when life is carbon-based. But one could imagine that the dominant form of life on Earth in the future is not carbon-based. Namely, if computers become self-aware, then you could imagine a time in the future where the dominant life form is not carbon-based. And it's not symmetric, by the way. At least, my Mac is prettier than a PC, but it's not symmetric in that sense. So I think when we say it's carbon-based, the earliest forms of life be carbon-based. Well, you might imagine the ultimate form of life, if it gets beyond the stage of intelligence, might not be carbon-based.
Indeed, we could perfectly well imagine visiting a planet where the original carbon-based life is completely extinct.
Yeah.
Or has emerged.
I mean, has to somehow
yes.
to keep up.
Yeah.
Anyway, but the nice thing about biology is you can argue about that. But the thing about if one talks about sort of physics, I'm not being facetious because a person asked this question the other day.
That's right. Let me put it explicitly. We've talked about an alien biology. What would an alien physics look like? And I take it would just be physics.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I tried it. You know, I was in China a few years ago when someone was talking about Eastern medicine. I said, there's no such thing as Eastern. Medicine is medicine. It's like Tim Minchin has a great skit. He talks about alternative medicine. And he says, you know what alternative medicine that works is called? Medicine. But the laws of physics are the same everywhere in the universe. And the reason I think it's important is because of another confusion. And it was asked last night in Portland. Some guy got up, and I didn't want to challenge him. I was just in the audience. But he took it as a matter of faith that we take it on faith, he said. He was talking about scientists having faith. He said, you take it on faith that the laws of physics are the same everywhere. No one takes it on faith. We test it. In fact, it's amazing that we can actually test, and people don't realize that. We can test that the laws of physics are exactly the same everywhere in the universe. Just by looking at the spectra of stars. Which requires electromagnetism, quantum mechanics, and relativity. And we could see exactly the same spectra in stars at the other end of the universe. So we could test that the laws of electromagnetism and quantum mechanics and relativity are the same everywhere. And so it's a remarkable fact. And we actually test it. Namely, we can ask the question, does it change from place to place, and does it change from time to time? And we could put limits on that, because you don't take that on faith. And so we can put limits that the strength of electromagnetism hasn't changed by more than one part in 100,000 over the last 10 billion years. We can test that. Even gravity, which is the weakest force in nature, we could test that hasn't changed by more than about 30% since the universe was 1 second old. We also checked to see if it's the same there as there. There was a tentative study that got a lot of excitement because it looked like spectra were a little bit different over there than there. It was some people in a variety of places in England and the United States, and it caused a lot of interest. It's probably wrong. Again, they were looking at changes at the level of one part in 100,000, where this level of sensitivity was just that level. But the amazing thing is that physics is uniform in space and uniform in time, and it's one of the wonderful things. And that's why physics is so much easier than biology.
I once was at a posh conference in Germany where the idea was they invited Nobel Prize winners, and each Nobel Prize winner was allowed to bring along one young squire, and I went along with Nico Tinbergen. And there was a distinguished Japanese physicist there, and he didn't say a word all through the entire conference, and then right at the very end, he asked if he might speak, and he said, "I have to speak because if I go back to Japan and say I didn't speak, I would lose honor." And he then said, "Western physicists are always talking about symmetries. In Japan, we have an aesthetic preference for asymmetry, so this changes our view of physics." Sort of vaguely interesting, but I'm a bit skeptical.
Well, no, actually, it's very important. I'm actually writing about it right now in a different sense. I mean, asymmetries are what make the universe interesting. Mm-hmm. If the universe were completely symmetric, we wouldn't be here. A symmetric universe would be beautiful, but boring. Yeah. It's the asymmetries. It's not just true in art, and everyone's pointed out that beauty involves some asymmetries. I mean, there's a lot of work on that. But in nature, it's asymmetry. It's the breaking of symmetry that's responsible for our existence. And it's a subject of actually part of the new book I'm writing. So,
You had another one.
Well,
I think we were going to do this.
Right. Yes.
Oh yeah.
Have you learned anything lately that surprised you?
Lord? Oh yeah. How reasonable? How special of you to ask that? Yes, and it's in biology. I was just talking about this recently on a TV program. We've talked about how you could ever learn about the origin of life, you know, that we can go back to the earliest common ancestor. But that period between the time life, whatever life is, formed, and the life that we now know, RNA-based or DNA-based, I mean, that's probably a long series of steps between whatever the first living things were. And again, at the early stages, it's hard to know what you mean by life. But the more advanced stages that ultimately involve cells and et cetera. And there's a really neat, I just learned that people can actually, there's some studies that are actually allowing us to learn about that early period, which I thought would never be accessible. And it involves the thing that makes you sleepy when you eat turkey. Tryptophan, which is one of the amino acids. And it's a long story, but the neat thing is it turns out that these people have been able to discover that it's actually incorporated. There are 20 amino acids, but it's incorporated in far fewer proteins than others. And in fact, they can now show that it was incorporated very late in the life process. So there are proteins that involve tryptophan, there are other ones that don't. And what they can now do is look at proteins that are involved. The next step will be to look at proteins that are involved in metabolism and cell division, and see which ones have, if they have tryptophan, then probably that aspect of life formed very late, because it was only happened after tryptophan was incorporated in the proteins. But if they don't, then the process happened early. So they can try and see whether metabolism formed before cell division or vice versa. We may be able to finally get a handle on that order of what happened first. As you know, Freeman Dyson thinks metabolism is more important than genetics, and other people think replication is more important than metabolism. And I just thought it would be a debate that people would just have ad nauseum, but we may actually be able to get data, and I think that's wonderful.
I've never understood how Freeman Dyson could possibly say anything other than that replication is...
Well, I think he's a contrarian.
And yeah, he is.
Yeah, he always... whatever people think is wrong.
But
he's a sharp guy.
Certainly. But you've got to have replication, or you can't have Darwinian natural selection, and therefore you can't have any kind of improvement. And I think that's just a no-brainer. The origin of life has got to be the origin of the first self-replicating entity.
Which, but, you know, he would say that Sephiroth gateway entity couldn't replicate without a metabolism at some level, and so I can see the arguments, but it's, but the point is, it's just talk until you have a way to test it, and I think it's really neat that, at least in this one area, I was kind of surprised, and I'm optimistic that maybe it might lead to, I actually do think that we'll learn the origin of life maybe in the next, in the lifetime of many people in this room.
It will never be for certain, will it? It will always be of the form, yes, that model is so neat and so clever and that it's just got to be right.
Well, I was going to ask you, but in fact, do you think we'll... So do you think it'll ever just be that, or do you think there'll ever be a better way of knowing that... of knowing in the sense that scientists know, sort of so highly likely that
it... Well, I suppose you could repeat it in the lab. But I suspect it's more likely to come from a model which will just be so brilliantly neat and elegant that...
It's interesting you say that. So you sort of think origins in biology could be kind of like origins in physics, because many people would say, you know, I've written about the origin of the universe, and ultimately it may come down to theoretical models, because although I'll spend time tomorrow talking about new optimism I have that we may be able to explore the very beginning of the universe. But ultimately it may be model-based, and I'm surprised, you know, biology is kind of an experimental science, so I'm surprised to...
Oh, there's a lot of model-making. There's a lot of modeling in biology. The whole of, Mendel, the sort of Morgan study of the order of genes along chromosomes is all done by not actually inspecting chromosomes. It was done by measuring things out in the real world, measuring frequencies of linkage between things. And of course, the triplet code, the DNA code, brilliantly modeled.
By a former physicist, I guess.
Yeah,
absolutely. I'm sorry. I had a great XKCD.
There's a lovely quote by a famous physicist beginning with W, who said something like, "It will all be so beautiful that we will say, oh, how could we not have realized it before?" It was something like that. I remember the name if you said it. It begins with W. I think we've probably talked about this before, but I can never really get a physicist to persuade me that he or she actually fully understands quantum theory. As I understand it, quantum theory's predictions, experimental predictions, are so magnificently fulfilled to so many significant figures that I think it was Richard Feynman who said it's equivalent to predicting the width of North America to the width of one human hair.
Yeah.
So that means, in some sense, it's got to be right. Yet the assumptions that quantum mechanical theory makes in order to derive those predictions just sound kind of loopy. and there are some physicists who seem to be macho enough to say, well, that doesn't matter, the mathematics works, and the experiments works.
Yeah, but
do they really understand it?
But they are loopy, and that's what's really important. They are completely nonsensical in a classical sense. And in fact, in my debates with the theologians who often use classical logic, I often say, well, that's fine, but maybe the universe doesn't use classical logic. And quantum mechanics is the perfect example. The things that electrons do are classically impossible. And no one understands. Feynman said, if you think you understand quantum mechanics, you're wrong. In fact, and I wrote a book called Quantum Man, which is about Feynman helping us understand quantum mechanics. But he was one of the first people that proposed quantum computers because what he said was, well, maybe that if a computer is using quantum mechanics to do calculations, maybe it'll help me understand how quantum mechanics works. Because no one, we can never intuitively fully understand quantum mechanics. In relativity, you could sort of understand in a way if you think about the thought experiments that Einstein did. Einstein did a set of logical thought experiments which lead you to realize that relativity kind of makes sense in a way. But quantum mechanics simply doesn't make sense. An electron is spinning in every direction before you measure it to be spinning in any direction. all at the same time. It's an electron that goes from here to there, is taking every possible path at the same time. And that just, it is weird. And someone was asking me again just this week, which is your favorite interpretation of quantum mechanics? And I don't like the question because, and it was a friend of mine who's now passed away at Harvard, Sidney Coleman, was a wonderful physicist. And he said, that's the wrong question. The question should be not what's the interpretation of quantum mechanics, it's what's the proper interpretation of classical mechanics. Because the world is quantum mechanical. The classical world is an approximation to this quantum mechanical world. So any classical interpretation of quantum mechanics is going to be weird and wrong. So you should say, how can we interpret classical mechanics in terms of the underlying reality? And because any interpretation you have, and I think the most reasonable one is the many worlds interpretation, sounds crazy because you're forcing this what reality to be described by something that isn't exactly right. And I don't think that that's the beauty of it, in the sense that it's an example of nature telling you, you know, you don't really like this. It seems really weird, but I don't give a damn. I mean, it's where we have to learn that what we think is sensible is fine, but what the universe thinks is sensible, you have to find out by looking at the universe.
I'm interested to hear that you favor the many worlds interpretation, because it seems to me that is not completely crazy. All it is ludicrously uneconomical.
Because it is, because
half the universe is the Schrödinger's cat is dead, and the other half the universe is Schrödinger's cat's alive. And have we got?
That'll work now. I have the light on. Now the power's on. Sorry.
Anyway, to go on with my story.
Yeah, you go on with your story.
There was a lovely cartoon in the New Yorker recently. In which it was in a vet's office, and the vet was coming out to the waiting room, and there was somebody there with a dog with one of those lampshades on, and the vet was saying, about your cat, Mr. Schrödinger, I have some good news and I have some bad news.
But you know, so physics is weird in that kind of confrontational sense, but biology is weird in many other ways. It's not, it's more intuitive, and that's why, unfortunately. And I think it's unfortunate that schools teach biology before they teach. There it is! Yay! I knew it would work once I got that light green. It doesn't matter. You can read it while I'm talking, or while Richard is. It's just a biologist, and it's about biology versus physics. I'm not going to.
Well,
read
okay.
It. But biology is more intuitive. So schools seem to think that they should teach it before physics, which I think is the wrong way around, because. Because then you learn by one of the reasons I didn't become a doctor like my mother wanted me to was because when I went to school, biology was just a lot of memorization.
Yeah.
And rules that you never learned why the rules were the way they are. But biology is based on chemistry, and chemistry based on physics. And so instead of learning these, you know, just you have to accept something, it's better if you learn about energy before you learn about biology and metabolism. So it's still kind of weird in a sense that. Well, besides being incredibly complex,
I'm wondering whether the weirdness of comparing classical physics with whether the reason we understand classical physics is that our brains were naturally selected as wild animals to move around in a world of classical physics. I mean, we had to survive in a world where you moved at medium speeds, not relativity sort of speeds, and. Interacting with reasonably large objects, not interacting at the quantum level, and whether we would find quantum theory.
But that's why I think we even talked about this once in the movie too. But that's why biology. That's why evolution's so weird for people is because we're also selected to think that a century is a long time.
Yes,
and we just can't picture the fact that biology works. In general, over much longer timescales.
But there's something much, much weirder about quantum theory than just that. I mean, getting your mind around hundreds of millions of years is not a thing you can intuitively do, but you can kind of just extrapolate from shorter.
Yeah, no, I mean, yeah.
The two-slit experiment with quantum, I mean, it's just.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
And that's why I think when it comes to deep questions, and when people, let's say the universe from nothing, when I talk about theologians who love the idea of cause and effect, here's an example of ultimate weirdness. If the universe began as a quantum fluctuation, but if it began, if space was created where there was no space, space and time are tied together. So space was created. People don't have a problem in their mind thinking of space suddenly being created. But space and time are tied together, so that means time was created. That means there may have been no time before the Big Bang. And
well,
that
I have
means
a problem with that. I have a problem with space being created as well.
Okay, well, good. But the thing is, that means cause and effect go out the window. Because if there's no before, cause and effect always requires that before and after. And if there is no before, then we have to just adjust our minds and realize that those kind of questions, which are sensible, seem sensible, are just not. But every time I learn something new about biology, I find it weird. For example, you know, it's true that the genetic code, I guess, makes me up, but some people tell me now that I'm much more influenced by the mass of bacteria that are in my body, which have much, much greater impact on my biology than any of the parts of my genetic code. And if that's the case, that means a lot of our thinking about what governs the way we are is really wrong too. So that means me as an entity is determined by bacteria, which you don't see, and even maybe the way I think, maybe the whether I'm in a good mood or a bad mood, all the things that you think are what make you up integrally as a human being are affected by things that are completely organisms that are not even, you wouldn't have even thought a part of you.
It's mildly surprising, but it's not. I mean, it's not in the same order of weirdness as.
Well, you know, I think what we discussed is that weirdness is in. Well, you know, actually, what I tell my students who learn physics is I tell them the first time you see it, you know, it doesn't make any sense. And the second time you say, oh, I've seen that before. It's just a matter of familiarity. Yeah. The kind of weirdness, you become more used to working with this stuff, and it probably depends on the eye of the beholder. Let me see. I think we should end up. We should give people time because we've gone on for almost an hour. You were going to ask this one, and then I'm going to. Yeah, there we go. We normally don't do this, but we decided to write them down because we were coming from different places.
Okay. Do we think science will ever come to an end when everything is known? I suppose we should answer that separately for physics and biology. It's a more important question for physics in a way. Well, is science going to come to an end when everything is known? We reach a kind of nirvana of knowledge and understanding.
I think the answer in physics is it's highly unlikely, based on the history of science, on the history of physics. People seem to think scientific truth is one of the least understood things because there is no such thing as scientific truth in the sense of absolute truth that applies under all conditions in all scales at all times. All of our theories, all of even the best theories we have, quantum electrodynamics, the thing that Feynman said predicts things from, you know, to an accuracy compared to human hair, compared to the size of the country. Even quantum electrodynamics is wrong. It's the best theory we have, but we know it ceases to apply at a certain scale of nature. And that seems to apply to every theory we have. So the theories are all successive approximations, and it's hard to imagine. First, that a theory will apply, that we'll have some theory that will apply on all scales, a theory of everything. But even if we had, a theory of everything would be really a theory of very little. Because the biggest thing in my field is trying to understand quantum mechanics and gravity so we can understand the origin of the universe. But we can understand most of the universe without understanding the origin of the universe. And even if we did understand the origin of the universe, it wouldn't tell us how oatmeal boiled. Literally, it wouldn't tell us about the detailed dynamics of even the physics of biological systems. So even if we had a theory that told us ultimately what the fundamental laws of nature were at a very small scale, we'd still be a tremendous amount of stuff and phenomena to describe on larger scales that would require new kinds of thinking.
Well, that's true, of course, and that would be the reason why biology may never end. But I wasn't very impressed with either of the two things you said before, where you were saying.
Oh, okay.
Well, okay. where you were saying to expect that it would apply at all scales, you simply embrace that in your theory of everything. It things happen at some scale, and then you change for a different scale. That's all part of the
theory. Well, no, but the theories change. There's no theory that is accurate on all scales.
Okay, well, I would bet there will be. And as for the historical point, that history tells us, well, of course history tells us that, because we haven't reached the end yet.
No, but I agree, but it actually is more than that. It turns out to be kind of a logarithmic thing. And so, you know, there's an infinite number of logarithms that you have to encounter, and at every logarithmic scale, the theories change. And so, it's but as I say, my point is that even if we did have and string theory has no evidence of being it. I should point out, it's an interesting idea, and it may pan out. It hasn't yet. Okay, no matter what you read, maybe we'll have a theory that tells us how do quantum mechanics and gravity work and how the universe began. But there still be a tremendous number of phenomena that, knowing that, will not help you understand, as I say, how oatmeal boils. And that's physics that's of a different sort. Or maybe how molecular motors work, what the physics of molecular motors is. So there's essentially almost an infinite number of different phenomena. And every time the other thing is, every time we turn on a new window on nature, we're surprised. And so therefore, surprised if those surprises stopped.
So far.
And, so I mean, far.
That would have to be true because we haven't reached the end yet. But I mean, I think I would bet that physicists will come up with a theory of everything, but that biologists will go on dealing with complexity, which is sort of what you were saying at the end, in a way, that there'll be lots of
detail. So you don't think biology will ever end?
Well, it's not the same thing because it will be lost in a morass of complexity.
So there'll be no theory that you can predict all possible life forms and that sort of thing.
I think no, because there's just too much going on. But I don't think that's a very profound lack. Lacking a physical theory of everything, I think, is an interesting thing. I think it's a really good question whether it's ever going to happen.
Well, I guess the real question is: are there ever going to be universal biological laws? I mean, physics, you know, starting with Newton.
Yeah, I don't think the word law is appropriate, really, for in the same way as it is in physics.
Okay, let's end, because I want to do two things. What's Richard Dawkins Foundation? What are you doing now that excites you with that?
The Openly Secular campaign, I suppose, is the main one, where we're trying to take a leaf out of the gay community's book. As you were saying earlier, Lawrence, there was a tremendous transformation in the status of gay people in America and in Western Europe as well, where they've got moved from being pariahs to being highly accepted, respected members of society, getting married, and have done it by coming out. And we are trying to encourage atheists and secularists to come out, set an example to show that we are ordinary, nice people who are good at doing things, and we're pleasant people, and we're friendly people, and we don't have horns and a tail. And we're trying to do it by getting people to do little YouTube videos of themselves, or selfie YouTube videos, where they say, I am a bus driver, I am a lawyer, I am a doctor, I am a fire engine driver, and I'm an atheist, or I'm a secularist. I'm openly secular. Secular rather than atheist, because I suppose we're trying to get a more all-inclusive people who are actually religious, because many religious people are also secular. That's one thing. Another thing is, sort of more minor things, working towards getting all our YouTube videos subtitled in many languages, especially Arabic, Urdu, Persian, to try to spread our YouTube net much more widely. We're sponsoring productions of Inherit the Wind, that magnificent play which was done as a film with Spencer Tracy about the Scopes monkey trial. It's the 90th anniversary of the Scopes monkey trial. And so we are sponsoring productions of Inherit the Wind by school dramatic societies in 90 schools around North America. Those are some of the, what else have we got? Oh yes, we've got the Teacher Institute for Evolutionary Science. One of the problems with middle school teaching of evolution is that teachers at middle school, I gather, in the United States, tend not to have science degrees. And they tend to be a bit intimidated about teaching evolution because they're accustomed to being, criticized very heavily by parents, sometimes by children, sometimes by other teachers. And they're not equipped to answer the criticisms because they don't know enough. And so we're starting a campaign to teach teachers teach evolution and how to combat the criticisms that they're likely to get.
You know, I want to add, I don't have foundation, but there's something involved in this related to something you said that I'm very pleased about and I want to promote, so I'll do it here. It's the opposite. I think it's really important to get those YouTubes out in Arabic, I think The Unbelievers has actually been subtitled in Arabic, okay, which I'm very happy about. Mm. But the opposite, I was very honored to be asked, it relates to something Miriam was talking about earlier. Raif Badawi, who many of you know of, who was arrested and subjected to lashing and 10 years imprisonment for blogging. His work was in Arabic, and there is now going to be a translation of his put into a book, and they asked me to write the foreword, which I just did, for his book, which is going to come out. And I think it's really important that we work the other way around, that the important people in those countries, as Miriam was saying, the people who are fighting for free thought, that they not be silenced. And so I was really proud and pleased to write the foreword, and I hope it becomes very popular, because we really need to give them a voice. And we should all do what we can to make sure those people are not silenced, because they are the future, in my opinion, of those countries. So, anyway. I think we should just stand for one. I think we've gone on long enough, and there are some questions, I guess. Yeah.
What teacher in school made the most impact on you, and why?
Well, I've written about this in my autobiography, yeah. So anybody who has read it, Mr. Johan Thomas taught me biology, and it's just possible that somebody hasn't heard me tell the story before, but just one memorable story. We were talking about Hydra, which is a small coelenterate, a small creature of fresh water. And he said, what animal eats Hydra? And he turned to the first boy, what animal eats Hydra? And the boy guessed, and what animal eats Hydra? What animal eats Hydra? And all around the class, he guessed. And by the end, we were all agog to know what animal eats Hydra. Sir, what animal does eat Hydra? And then he waited. To total silence, and then he said, I don't know. I don't know. And I don't think Mr. Coulson knows either. Mr. Coulson! And he rushed to the door, opened the door, flung open the door, and led in his senior colleague who was teaching in the next room. Mr. Coulson, do you know what animal eats Hydra? Mr. Coulson said, no. And I think none of us have ever forgotten that lesson, and that just epitomizes this man. He inspired me, I think he inspired many people to become biologists.
I don't know if I can compete with that. That's a great story, and it's a great teacher. I was fortunate, by the way. I think I had a whole set of wonderful teachers who got me excited, and particularly allowed me to be me, which I think is the most important thing. There were teachers who were a little upset at me being me, but probably I would say not a science teacher. I had a lot of good science teachers, but for me it was an English teacher who really got me excited about the need to communicate. I think the importance of communication and the opportunities to do so in many different ways. Not just in literature, but in movies. We all had to watch movies and compare it to books. And it was just a matter of being exposed to things that movies we should never have seen. I was 12 or 13 years old, and we should never have been allowed to, well, many school boards would not have allowed us to see the movies we saw. But it was eye-opening. And the fact that you were allowed to think about subjects and talk about subjects, once you talked about subjects, any subject, then anything was game. And for me, that just emboldened me to, I think it was very important.
If science is a tool in the search for truth, can you imagine a way to improve on the scientific method to be more effective in our search?
Well, science does improve all the time. And one of the big improvements in biological medical science is the control experiment, the double-blind control experiment, which is utterly simple, very ingenious, and extremely crucial, extremely important. So I suppose things like that in biology are the improved techniques that I admire. During my lifetime, a little bit longer than that, experimental design has improved massively. If I look back at the early experiments of my old mentor, Nico Tinbergen, and they're terrible. They never get published today. They're pretty much anecdotal, very poorly controlled, against observer bias. Nowadays, experiments are always arranged in such a way that the experimenter's bias, as far as possible, doesn't enter into it. Either biased in favor of getting the result he wants, or if he's very scrupulous, biased the other way. The double-blind trial does guard against that, and it's so simple and yet so ingenious, and that has swept through medical science pretty much during my lifetime, I think.
Well, you know, let me first say the simple answer is no. The scientific method, ultimately the scientific method hasn't changed. It works, it worked. It's the reason we're doing science, the basic notion of testing, making hypotheses, testing, and falsifying hypotheses, and moving on and testing again and repeating. That is the only way, what we know of, to get knowledge. I would say there's no other, in my opinion, there's no other way that we gain knowledge about the world. But tools, and double-blind in biology is just a small part of something that's bigger, I think, and that's really changed is the understanding of statistics, of how to properly tell whether something's significant. And that's what we do in double blind. But you know, often if you do a physics experiment and you're looking over a wide range, you'll always find something crazy. And many people, all of us in life, have that same, something weird happens to us and we think it's significant. But we forget every day when weird things didn't happen to us. Yeah. I often tell a story of Richard Feynman who would go up to people and say, "You won't believe what happened to me today. You won't believe what happened to me." And they'd say, "What?" He'd say, "Absolutely nothing." And so we have built a whole series of techniques to tell whether seemingly significant results are in fact significant. And I'll talk about one tomorrow in a really important way. But here's an interesting fact. I think we're not there yet. In quantum electrodynamics, which is the best theory in nature that we have, almost all the original experiments, almost all of them, differed from the final result by what we call 2 sigma. Which means, 2 sigma means that there's a 95% likelihood that the number you're giving is right. Well, it turns out things that should happen 5% of the time in science happen now about 50% of the time. So the way we determine likelihood is still...
So humans have one less chromosome than other apes, and two of them fused. This seems to defy the gradual process of evolution as I understand it, insofar as mom and dad would have 24 and Junior would have 23. Would Junior be the same species as her parents?
Oh, good.
This is a very interesting question.
Yeah.
It's true. All the other great apes have 48, and we have 24, and we have 23. And we know exactly what happened. We know that two chromosomes fused together. They joined together. And you can actually see the join. You can actually see that this is chromosome whatever it is in a chimpanzee, and that's chromosome whatever it is in a chimpanzee. They have actually joined together end to end. So it's a magnificent, spectacular demonstration of evolution. As to whether you call it gradual, well, who cares? I mean, it's clearly in one sense not gradual. It's clearly in another sense extremely gradual. It's just a single event, a single joining event. So that is just one event. But it's dramatic in the sense that it's one fewer chromosomes. It doesn't matter what you call it. That's a semantic question. What it is a truly spectacular demonstration of evolution, which really couldn't be explained in any other way.
Not just explained, but I use it as an example of what a lot of people say evolution is, which it isn't. They say it's historical science, and they say historical science is different. But all science is historical science. But if it were just historical science, it would just be telling stories. But what you do is take evidence from the past and make predictions about what things you haven't seen, whether it's 5 minutes ago or 50 million years ago. And that was a prediction, right? You say, look, great apes have one more chromosome than humans. If they evolved from a single common ancestor, then one of them must have fused. It's a prediction. Yeah. And in fact, the prediction was made before it was seen exactly where the fusing was. So it's an example of the fact that evolution actually predicts things, or evolutionary biology makes predictions about the future. Yeah. But the other thing is, it may, you know, we also confuse form and function, so that fusing, that ultimate fusing, may have been a partial fusing at some intermediate state species. Who knows? I don't know. I mean, it didn't have to happen in the exact form that it's been seen now. I don't know if you... And so...
Well, I wouldn't mind if it did. I
mean, yeah, but it didn't have. It could have been a series of stages.
As for whether Junior was the same species as its parents, again, who cares? The question is, I mean, would it have been incapable of interbreeding?
Yeah.
And my guess is it would have been capable of it.
Do you have difficulty suspending disbelief when you see a film that has supernatural or religious elements?
If it's a good film. I mean, you know, I've obviously written about science fiction a lot, and the best thing about science fiction is not the science, it's the story. And if it's a good story and grips you and is interesting, then you're willing to suspend disbelief. If it's a stupid story, then you don't want to. And what you want to have is that the elements that you have to suspend disbelief for not be so glaringly ridiculous that you give, like, take for instance Interstellar, the worst movie ever made. Not quite. There's a lot of worse movies. But there are some things that just are so glaringly stupid that you can't enjoy the good stuff. So for me, it just depends on whether it's a good story, and that wasn't, and whether the things that I'm required to disbelieve, for example, from biology, somehow that the life is dying on Earth because there's a blight. Right, but it took 2 billion years to build up the oxygen on Earth for plants and for 2 billion years they had to create oxygen. One generation, if we could burn all the crops on Earth right now, there'd still be oxygen. I mean, just simple things like that. So if you do something so stupid, then it. What about you?
That applies to science fiction. But I mean, the general question, it's no more difficult than when you read a novel. You know the characters in the novel never really existed, but you empathize with them. You get it under their skins. You feel sad when they die. I mean, you can do all that. I can feel emotional about Bach's St. Matthew Passion, not just because it's beautiful music, but because of the story. I mean, I'm at least as irreligious as anybody in the room, but I still can empathize with this story, with this beautiful music of J.S. Bach.
If it's beautiful, and if it is not so implausible that you can't empathize,
yes.
I guess.
Yeah.
And I'm told this is to be the last question.
Oh, good.
So.
Yeah. Oh.
You guys can kill me later.
There's a bar out there, I hope, so that, you know, okay.
If God is a delusion, is there any point in having conversations with the deluded about God?
Yes, clearly, because, I mean, they are... It's a tragedy that people are deluded when they could be learning the wonderful truth of the world in which we live. I mean, as a lifelong educator, I am deeply offended by people being taught falsehoods when they could be being taught the truth, because the truth is so beautiful. And we haven't even started on the evils that are done in the name of the delusion. So there's every reason for having conversation with the deluded and persuading them.
But yeah, even more generally, we are all deluded about many things, and that's the purpose
of it. Speak for yourself.
You were deluded about Teilhard de Chardin, for
example.
Yeah,
I was, yeah.
Okay. The point and purpose of education is to confront those delusions. That's the whole point, is to confront the deluded. At the same time, it can be frustrating. As someone just wrote to me that, you know, fighting with someone like that is like getting in a mud pile with a pig and fighting the pig. Everyone gets dirty and the pig enjoys it. But anyway. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.